your way out. The community cop. It's a blessing to see your face today.
Welcome, welcome to another edition of Community Cop. Cop, namaste, namaste. My name is Michael Greys, co-founding member of 100 Blacks in Law Enforcement Who Care. And today I'll be flying solo. Noel Leader, Julian Harper, Father Lawrence Lucas, they're all on Community Cop assignment at this time. I thought, you know, we'd have a full assemblage the day, but that didn't work out. So hopefully next week I'll be joined by the whole Community Cop team. But at this time I have to hit the ground running. You know, it's obligatory that I do that, mandatory, and certainly they have to know that I got to be right on point to make this happen. So let's get started. First of all, from the outset, to y'all that know, we always have a reflection in history as to who or whom did what on at this particular time. And this week, we're full of illuminaries. I'll keep it short with respect to time, but I picked out three that we have to, this week in history, we have to call their name. And certainly the African tradition says to call their names of ancestors keeps them alive, and certainly we believe in that. We believe that it's good and it's healthy to call their names because they're the shoulders that we're standing on as we speak and as we do our due diligence to continue their struggle. So from the outset, let's look at, this is the anniversary of Special Field Order 15 by General William Tecumseh Sherman. Now, you might not be familiar when I say Special Field Order 15. However, you're familiar with it. If I said to you 40 acres and a mule, well, that's Special Field Order 15. Now, that was done on January 16th, 1865 by, as I said, General William Tecumseh Sherman. This was at a point where during the Civil War, near the end of it, the general put out a military order to give all the former enslaved Africans who were trailing him and behind him, giving them land. So he was actually, as he was moving forward, were designating plots of land to black folks and wanted them to, if there were the accompaniment of mules or whatever animals, then to give them that to get them started in their trek to be free and independent. So he had did that until the order was eventually countermanded by a president that many of you love, Abraham Lincoln, and you attribute our freedom to. He had nothing to do with our freedom. It was actually done by our own hands, you know, the black soldiers, over 200,000 strong that fought in the Civil War, were the ones that freed us. But with respect to this date, Special Field Order 15, keep that in mind, or to some who embrace it with the 40 acres and a mule. Well, it was in effect for a while. As you can see, if you go to the Gullah Islands and you look in South Carolina and along the coast of Georgia, you see a lot of land that was given to us. We really earned it. Nothing has been given to us, but we earned it, and certainly some will still have that land to this day. Many of it was confiscated due to Abraham Lincoln countermanding the order, and then later President Johnson, after he was assassinated, Andrew Johnson had hated black people to the highest degree. He sent generals, you know, and a famous general, General O. Howard, sent him back into the South to reverse ownership of the land and to give it back to white folks that wanted their land back. So that was to the, you know, that happened to people who had loved General O. Howard, because he was known as the religious general at that time. So that's Special Field Order 15. Let's move quickly. This is the anniversary of somebody. We're in rarefied air when we say his name, and that's Muhammad Ali. His birthday is 1/17, 1942. So this week is the birthday of the greatest heavyweight of all time, boxer of all time, and a brilliant spokesperson, a real leader, a real person who inspired so many outside of the boxing realm, just in life, and gave us somebody to look up to, not only while he was performing his craft, but just as a person who was a spokesperson for the Nation of Islam. And what an incredible, beautiful boxer. The artistry that he had, the syntax he used in his rhymes, the logic he applied to everyday life, a wonderful man, a great man in his own right, Muhammad Ali. I'm tempted to say the greatest boxer that ever lived, but he was the greatest heavyweight. The greatest boxer that ever lived, in my humble opinion, is the great Sugar Ray Robinson, who Muhammad Ali himself idolized and took some things from him, you know, was able to redo some of the things he saw Sugar Ray do in the ring. But the art itself, the pure artistry of Muhammad Ali, is no doubt about it, was the greatest. Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. It's no doubt about it. That's what he was, and a great man. And certainly he refused, as we all know, and this what made the world acknowledge him, when he refused to participate in the Vietnam War. And he said those famous words, "No Vietnamese ever called me the N-word." So, you know, with that in mind, he lost millions of dollars, but he gained the respect of so many people, you know, all over the world for doing that. So what he lost in money, he was compensated with the respect which he truly deserved. So long live the spirit of Muhammad Ali, and we should never forget him. And certainly that name is in rarefied air. And last but not least, certainly Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., one of the great leaders of the civil rights movement, a movement that brought in and accomplished a lot of things. Now, many things that the civil rights movement accomplished was because of the counterbalance of the Black Power movement. The civil rights movement was able to generate and move the meter. It certainly did. There's no question about it, because you was going to have to deal with the civil rights movement, or you would have to deal with the Black Power movement. And white folks, when it comes to that, are very consistent. They'd rather deal with what they considered an integrationist movement. Many of them looked at those as Negroes anyway, so they were better to deal with. Nixon came out and said, you know, take good care of the Negroes, you know, take take good care of Uncle Tom's. And I'm not characterizing everybody in the civil rights movement as Uncle Tom's, because we had some giants. And Dr. King was one of them, and Mega Evers, and, you know, so many others, you know, that became really great leaders in their own right, were in the civil rights movement, and it accomplished a lot. You know, Civil Rights Act, 64, Voters' Rights Act, 65, the Fair Housing Act, you know, 68, so many things that it transpired that we have to acknowledge, certainly the civil rights movement. And, you know, and from his inception as a leader, the Montgomery Improvement Association, it was the beginning to a death knell to certain forms of Jim Crow and segregation. So that was a momentous victory, but it had happened actually earlier in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. But to those that, those that didn't know that, but the Montgomery Improvement Association was able to, in a 13-month period, destroy the rule that, you know, blacks had to sit in the back of the bus. And even if you were in the middle of the bus, which Rosa Parks was at that time, if white folks filled the front of the bus and they wanted you to move, you'd have to move. So certainly for your dignity and integrity, and especially when you're paying the same amount of money that white folks are paying to get on the bus, it was very important for that victory to happen. And that opened up a lot of things in the South by what happened in Montgomery, Alabama at that time, because most of us didn't know about Baton Rouge, what happened, you know, almost a year earlier with Reverend Jimison, their victory and their bus boycott. So, of course, again, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., one of the all-time greats. Obviously, it'll be a lot of things going on in the coming days in his name. So, and he's the only black person that has a federal holiday. The other ones we need to take, you know, whether it's Malcolm. I go to the pilgrimage to Malcolm's gravesite every year. And certainly that's done by, Dr. Leonard Jeffries, as well as Brother Professor James Smalls. They lead the pilgrimage every year. And that's a good thing to attend. And any other, whether it's Black Solidarity Day and other days, take them. But the only one that has a recognized national federal holiday is Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And so certainly big ups to him and his family for all that he was able to accomplish. Let's get started. Now, from the outset, I want to just give you an update again on last week. And this was one of the most heinous acts by a police officer. And this police officer, and it's interesting that Noel last week, this was, I don't recall Noel using these terms when he described this police officer. He called the police officer, if I remember correctly, he called him a sociopath as well as sadistic. And I've heard Noel use our various terms in describing certain acts, certainly with his vast experience in law enforcement. But in this particular one, I took note of those words, because a sociopath, that's another level over a psychopath, because a psychopath might be in and out of a certain frame of reference, a certain mindset, but the sociopath feels nothing when he kills. And this particular police officer, DeCruz, and the Temple, Texas Police Department, he just recently killed a black man, 28 years old, for no apparent reason in a car stop. The black man was unarmed, which they admit. They freely admit he was unarmed. They did not characterize whether it was for, did he stop him for a broken tail light? Was it, was he speeding? Was it a red light? What did he do? They didn't even give an official report as to that. They admitted he was unarmed and said he was evading. They didn't say what evasive tactics he used, but he's standing right in front of a police officer, and the police officer subsequently shot him in the head, killing him. Now, while that's being decided, he also, in 2017, now this was in December of 2019, nothing has been done yet. Again, and now we well into January. But in 2017, he killed a black child. This same police officer, DeCruz, killed a black child, intentionally ran a police car over a black child, stayed on top of the black child for 10 minutes. Now, the under the car, certain car parts heat up. Those heated car parts actually burn the skin, the torso, the arm, and certain parts of this 15-year-old child's body. He remained with the car idling on top of this 15-year-old child for 10 minutes. Onlookers were astonished. They could not believe that he stayed on top of this child intentionally. This is why Noel described him as a sociopath and sadistic. And I can't think of better words to use. I just can't top that in any way. He was a sadistic. He is a sociopath that's still patrolling the streets of Temple, Texas. And so now nothing has been done. And if we go back to 2017, when he did that, there's a lawsuit, but that lawsuit will not bring justice. It will be a lawsuit where maybe the family will get some economic recompense. But with respect to justice, justice will not happen in that case. Maybe, hopefully, something will be decided in this current case where he just shot a young man for no apparent reason. Nothing officially they can report can justify his action. So we'll be mindful of that and look up the case. You know, it's police officer DeCruz in Temple, Texas. He shot the young man, Michael Dean, 28 years old. Look it up, and hopefully we're going to keep our ears to the ground and see what happens in this case, because this one was just so horrific in front of people that they couldn't even write a report to officially describe what happened and kept the media out of that process for a while. So let's see what happens with that. Now, there are two more incidents, and so normally we do a lot of you know, pointing out things in law enforcement and politics. But these are educators that I want to talk about now, and just double checking the time since I don't have the time in front of me. There's a teacher. There's two teachers in particular. But let's look at in Palm Coast, Florida. You know people down there in Palm Coast. In Palm Coast, Florida, at the Buddy Taylor Middle School, there's a teacher, Jeffrey Perfuma. He's 47 years old. There was a 14-year-old student in his class that was merely on the computer, turned the computer to some music. And he goes over there to the table, and rightfully so, to where the student was sitting, and muted the music. Well, this 14-year-old child unmuted it and had the music on again, and the teacher muted the music again. And at that point, words were exchanged. Now, allegedly, after some words were exchanged, whatever was said, the school teacher choked him out because he said that the 14-year-old referred to him as a cracker. Now, what he said to that young man to provoke, because most students do not address their teachers in that way. So I don't know what he said to the young man, But he reported that the young man, the young child, rather, he's not a man, 14 years old, he's a child. This youngster was, he claims the youngster called him a cracker. And so what he did was he snatched the child out of the seat, put him in a chokehold, carried him out, you know, carried him out of the class, and threw him to the ground. This is in Palm Coast, Florida. So this not in the backwoods of Mississippi, Alabama, somewhere, Georgia. This is in Florida, and this was done, and there's an investigation going on, but it's a temporary leave of absence is what the teacher's got. He's not suspended. He's not fired. Now, in this particular case, similar to the police officer, this teacher has history. He assaulted something. Now, this teacher, by the way, has been teaching for several decades. He started at this school in 2005. He has prior incidents with students, and he has even a prior conviction of battery. He has a prior conviction of battery and another charge that he had was dismissed. But the battery charge he was convicted of in 2002. So here you have a teacher that has a history of violence. Now he's was violent with this student, and they just and a battery charge is just considered in most states a misdemeanor. Battery. So in Florida it's considered a misdemeanor. Consequently, the most he would do if he was convicted of it could do up to a year in jail. But I have a suspicion that's highly unlikely that's going to happen. But the child has been traumatized, as you would if you was a little child and you were snatched out of your seat, put in a chokehold, was choking, yet, you know, he was breathing enough so he didn't pass out, picked him up, took him out of the class, and threw him. I think got out of the classroom door, threw him to the ground, and that was that. So this is how black children are handled. You know, you could have walked them to the dean's office, the assistant principal, or the principal's office, walked them there, called his parents, said there's a problem. But no, they chose to get physical and put the child in a chokehold, which could have caused irreparable damage physically as well as psychological scars on that child. And that could affect the child the rest of his life. So this 47-year-old man, 6'2", 243 pounds, that's what the affidavit said. So I'm not making it up. So he's a big man, you know, the size of a football player, choking a little 14-year-old little child. So this is a teacher with two decades or more of experience. So there you have it. We need to be mindful of that. And certainly if you look and you're in that Palm Coast area, demand that this person is fired. Demand it and see what happens. Let's look at another story, and I'm checking the time because we're gonna get to the phones today. As soon as I finished, it's one more thing. Now, in a little closer to home, there's another school teacher. Want to point this out. Now, that teacher was in Palm Coast, Florida. This one is right here in New York State, actually in Long Island. This high school teacher took students, and they're not releasing his name at this time. This high school teacher took students to the Bronx Zoo. And some of you that know history well and you say zoo, you probably already thinking, you know, the likely scenario. Well, this teacher took students to the Bronx Zoo, and after going on the field trip, came by and did a caption where he characterized four black students who were there with him he said he characterized them as monkeys and gorillas. So the parents obviously were upset at this teacher because the caption was called Monkey Do, where he basically aligned those four students. Out of all the students in the class, the four black ones, he characterized them as monkeys and gorillas. Now, with all of these so-called things that are occurring, anti-Semitism, these claims of anti-Semitism that's going all over, well, what are these black elected officials going to do now? They were all out there marching across the Brooklyn Bridge and having meetings and assembling all over the place. Well, where are the black elected officials? And I'm not even talking about in Long Island. I'm talking about right here in New York City. What are they going to do? Tish James is the attorney general for New York State. Long Island is a part of New York State. What's she going to do with all these other elected officials? Now, what's Governor Cuomo going to do? Governor Cuomo has found millions of dollars, and sending state police officers to protect Jewish institutions. Okay, fine. What are you going to do to protect black children? What are you going to do for the black community? Governor Cuomo. Now here you you get a lot of votes and a lot of action, political support from the Long Island community. Now, what are you going to do about a situation where black children are being told that they are monkeys and gorillas? How is that acceptable? How do black elected officials? Man, where's Adam Clayton Powell when you need him? You know, yeah, obviously we know he's been dead for close to 50 years. 72, and this is 20, 48 years. And black elected officials walk around all pompous and got all these titles and honorable titles, and yet you can call black children monkeys. A teacher. These teachers have been around for years. The school superintendents say it was culturally offensive and insensitive, but that's just a normal word noise. The insensitive superintendent in Florida just said the same thing. It was insensitive and that we don't tolerate that. You know, they say the school teacher talk. You know, obviously that doesn't reflect what we're about, our behavior, our character, you know, things like that. But the teacher still got a job teaching that we're monkeys. Now, why don't some of our black scholars go out there and say the real truth? Black man and woman, first people on the planet. Fact. Civilization comes out of Africa. Fact. Highest civilization, earliest civilization, the Nile Valley. Fact. The highest level, ancient Kemet. Fact. Why don't you teach that they taught the Romans and Greeks? A fact. Why don't the scholars teach that? Why don't you teach basic science? Black is dominant. White is recessive. You can't get black from the white, but you can get white from the black. The black man is the original man. No scientist of note, none, will tell you white people were the first ones on the planet. They'll all tell you that white people are the last people on the planet. Been around 40, 50,000 years. That's it. We've been here 6 million. Fact. I know the discovery of Lucy was 3.5 million years ago, but Lucy had a daddy and a mother. 6 million years, facts, straight out of Africa. Had we stayed in Africa, the whole world would look like us. Wouldn't even be. So what does that mean? You talking of comparing us to apes and you a mutant. You're not the original people of the planet. Now, if you want to claim Neanderthals, which you are part Neanderthals, they were around 200,000 years. But they're not humans. And that's even by your definition, not ours. You say that to be a human, you have to have a forehead and a forebrain. They didn't have that. Neanderthals didn't have that. So if you want to claim that to give yourself another 150,000 years, you have at it. Have at it. But you always, to this day in 2020, still making mockery of black men and women, calling us monkeys. Gave civilization to the world, the written word to the world, science, mathematics, engineering, architecture to the world. Can you imagine? Go to Kemet. Look at pyramid text. I'm not even telling you to look at papyrus. I'm not even telling you about the 600,000 books we had in libraries. Wayset, Luxor, Karnak, all these books of learning. Imhotep the first, master teacher, builder, doctor, all of that. And you still calling us monkeys. That's sick. Come from us, mutants, got the nerve to talk about us the way you do. Go to your scientists. You can get mad at me if you want to. I'm not apologizing. Go to your scientists. Go to Columbia. It's nearby. Go to Columbia. Go to Yale. Go to Oxford. Go to Princeton, Harvard, any of them, and ask them, where you from? Don't worry about us. Ask them. Ask them who were the first men that stood upright on the planet. Ask them where civilization truly comes from. In what you call Western civilization. The Greeks got it from us. They sent their children to Africa to learn while you were still eating each other in the caves of Europe. Facts. Check it out. But at this point, we'll stop because I'm sorry. It's time. I went over. I tried to do it on time. But let's go to the phones. First caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from?
Hey, Brother Peace. Is this me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I'm Brother Kareem. I'm calling from Queens. I'll be very quick. Wonderful show. Excellent work as usual.
Thank you.
And I just want to say that two wonderful ancestors, Dr. Khaled Abdul-Muhammad and Leola Maddox, were both born, I believe, on January 12th.
Yes, we did it last week. But tell me, give me at least a positive word about either of them. You know, both of them are near and dear to my heart. Sister Leola Maddox, oh, what a beautiful human being. She led the United African Movement with her husband for close to 30 years, around 30 years. And certainly we had a beautiful memorial. Thank you, Sister Judy, for being a part of that, and certainly Dr. Khaled, who myself as well as Noel had a personal relationship with. They were great in their own right. Any words you want to say about them?
Well, I met Dr. Khaled twice for very short stints, and it's really amazing how the love he has for his own people.
That's right.
It was actually shocking to me how different he is and how loving he is at a one-on-one, just a handshake.
Down
as
earth,
opposed
right?
to the image that we all saw of the flaming, fiery, militant.
That's right. Very down to earth, right?
Brother, to me, and he loved his own people.
Sincere
first,
down to
and
earth.
And foremost.
Mrs.
Maddox, I remember I used to be at the Slave Theater every Wednesday 30 years ago.
Right.
I always remember Miss Maddox as a quiet fire.
That's right.
I don't believe I ever heard her speak, but she was always right at that back door.
Yes.
But just with a very loving spirit, supporting her husband through thick and thin.
That's right.
And I don't know, before I get a little too emotional, I just want to say that they're as worthy of honor as anybody else.
That's right.
That we can think of.
Yes.
So I just want to say to you, keep up the good work, brother. And
thank you for that call, man. And I'm going to use that. That's a beautiful way to describe Sister Leola, you know, Leola Maddox. Certainly, quiet fire. Beautiful. I love that. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from?
How you doing, brother?
Good,
this is Luther from Harlem.
All right, good, good, good.
I used to see you once in a while.
Yes.
I just want to know why, whenever you see an expedition, it's never in Europe. It's always in Africa. They always in there digging up something, stealing our legacy. Thank you very much, brother. Love talking to you, and hope the crew come back soon. Have a blessed one.
Thank you, brother. Thank you for the kind words, and certainly you said it right. They're stealing. They're not digging and just finding things. They're stealing. And you're absolutely right about that because it's ours. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from?
Next caller.
Yes, sir, brother Mike. Salaam alaikum, Kareem from Harlem.
Wa alaikum salam.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, most merciful, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. Brother, you're right on point again. I just want to say, Brother Khalid, as you know, when we go to the pilgrimage for Malcolm on his birthday, I always go over to his grave site.
Yes.
And I believe y'all do the same thing. And the brother was definitely mindful of trying to wake up the youth to what our people struggle for and try to get them to understand that we need to defend ourselves as we were being attacked by these devils. That was something that I really liked it about Brother Khalid. And Sister Leola, as far as I'm concerned, when I went to the UAM for the meeting, I understood the power that she had because she loved her people also. Now, this is my comment as far as what's going on. I just want our people to realize that this president is getting ready to start World War III, and, brother, what is most important is our people are going to be the one dying on the war field for these devils. Their kids are not gone. So that's very important. Secondly, this so-called candidate for president, Buttigieg and Biden, neither one of them is for our people because they have shown that they do not care about our people and they have said racist actions against our people. My last point is this here, brother, is that our people have so many ancestors which have, you know, contributed to our upliftment, and we can really not even answer all of them. But, brother, you're right on point on what you're saying, and we've got to do for ourselves. If we don't do for ourselves, nobody else will. So, brother, keep doing a great job, and may Allah bless you and the family.
Thank you, brother.
As-salamu alaykum.
Wa alaykum salam. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from?
How you doing, Brother Mike? Happy New Year to the Community Cop family and Sister Keisha. I hope everybody is doing well.
Sister Keisha, it's good to hear from you, and certainly I know you back in the cold weather. You was renewing your vows after, 20 years?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Well, first of all, I just wanted to give commentary to a question you asked about where are all these black politicians. There are no black politicians. There are no black politicians. And I want the listeners and the viewers to understand that the more you engage in this unpolitical process, the worse our conditions get. We have to understand that at some point, we have to stand our ground.
That's right.
This war is physical and it is spiritual, and we are not engaging with season. And that's something that Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad taught me. As far as Queen Mother Leola Maddox, we all know she was a giant, a silent giant in her own right.
That's right.
All of the monumental accomplishments we made legally here in the city and state of New York came by way of Sister Leola Maddox. She is sorely missed.
That's right.
But I want our brothers and sisters who are of the baby boomer generation, I want you to understand that those of us of the Generation X, we're not tolerating the nonsense anymore. We don't want any lip service. There's a reason why black votership has declined on a national and local level. It's because we have waged a mass movement to abstain from the vote right now. Until these politicians come with an agenda specifically for us, they cannot get our vote. And I don't give a damn what happens to this country. Let Babylon fall. Yeah, this country deserves another 4 years Trump. It deserves exactly what it gets. I hope it gets much worse. And all of you who are scared, you really don't know the level of intelligence of Dr. Khalid Abdul-Muhammad or Leona Maddox. Let Babylon fall. Do not engage in this political process anymore until we get what we want. I don't give a damn about women's rights. I don't give a damn about immigrant rights. I don't give a damn about midget rights. I want African rights. And until we get that, don't give none of these bastards a vote. None of them.
That's right. Love that spirit. We going to see you tomorrow night?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good, good. Because, you know, we have the Professor William Mackey lecture series, and I'll see Keisha tomorrow night there, Wednesday night, 103 Quincy Street, 103 Quincy Street. Is that it, sis?
I hope more of you show up at 103 Quincy Street. It's time to stop all the lip service, and let's really put our knuckles to the ground.
That's
because
right.
Because we're playing with ourselves, and each generation that comes up after is in worse and worse condition. So come on out to 103 Quincy Street tomorrow and holla at your girl and holla at Big Mike. We'll see you. Y'all stay up.
All right now. Good. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from? Next caller, you on the air. The board is full. Next caller, don't listen to your TV. Listen to your phone. You're on.
I don't know, Brother Ray Ray.
Yes, brother, you holding us up, brother? Come on.
Well, I was waiting for the beef. How you doing, Mike? How you doing, Community Cop? Listen, unfortunately, the Earth Day of Dr. Khalid and Miss Maddox, that Boule played a big hand in Dr. Khalid's murder.
Yes,
you
sir.
You got to look at that. Tomorrow, all roads lead to African Helping Africans, Dr. William Mackey Lecture Series at 103 Quincy Street.
That's right.
And you got to remember, family, Miss Leola Maddox, that trailblazer, believed in lectures and information to the black community so bad.
Especially for children.
She drove her car all the way over the George Washington Bridge. All the way to the UAM because she believed in lectures. She believed in information. And
right.
That's what we're doing at Professor Mackey's and Asking Helping Africans. Tomorrow, if you believe in Miss Maddox, if you believe in Dr. Khalid, if you believe in information to the black community, all roads lead to Dr. Mackey's and African Helping Africans lecture series tomorrow.
103 in Quincy Street, that's the corner of Franklin.
103 Quincy Street,
730.
Corner of Franklin Avenue. She drove that car. She worked two jobs. She ate her dinner in UAM.
That's right.
Because she believed in information. She paid that toll. And she came there, rain, sleet, snow, no matter what. Miss Maddox was there.
That's right.
Because she believed in information. So all the family, if you still believe in information, come on out. Dr. Lewis will be there. He's going to give an impeccable lecture on Africa on the Move. You're going to hear a whole lot of information. Come on out in honor of Miss Maddox, in honor of Mike Graves, in honor of Keisha, in honor of Dr. Khalid, in honor of Malcolm X, honor Amos Wilson. Come on out. Michael Bradley's the Iceman Inheritance to tell you about these cave people who are walking on all fours. Khalid tells you that all the time.
That's right.
Hope to see you tomorrow, family. Thank you, Mike.
All right. Good, good, good. And that's the director of the Africans Helping Africans, Dr. Mackey Lexus Series, Brother Ray. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from?
Hello?
Yes, you're on the air.
Hello, yeah. My name is A-Train, and I'm from the Bronx.
Yes.
And I'd like to congratulate everyone who has called you this evening. You understand? With respect to our comedic presence on the planet, yes, we are the first people on the planet, but we are in an advanced state of dysfunctionalism.
Mm-hmm.
We need to do is coalesce. We have to come together and do it quickly. We have a madman at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue.
Right.
And the sooner that we recognize this, brother, we will overcome the situation.
As soon as we recognize what, brother? Trump?
You understand that this man has no love for us.
Right. He's not our brother. Yeah, go ahead.
You understand?
Yes.
He has no love for us. He is not seeking to include us in his program. His people are working against whatever we want, whatever we need, whatever we have to have in order to be a viable force on this planet. We are the first people.
Yes.
We are the first people on this planet. And we have to realize this. Everyone else comes out of us.
Yes.
I'm a Columbia University graduate. You spoke about Columbia University.
Yes.
I come from that background.
Okay, excellent.
And, oh, I know what it is. I know what it is to sit in a class and be the only white, non-white person in that class.
Mm.
You understand? We have to coalesce. Otherwise, we are doomed to fail.
Yes,
we
yes.
are going under.
Okay, thank you very much.
I salute you for your message.
Thank you. Thank
God
you, but
bless
it's,
you.
Thank you, but it's not my message. It's the message that Dr. Jeffries, Dr. Clark, Dr. Ben, and so many others, it's their message. They're the teachers. You know, John Hope Franklin, Asa Hilliard, Ashwan Crazy. It's all of us that has taught us this, that, you know, we didn't come from a plantation. That long before there was a plantation, thousands of years before there were any doctors, we were the doctors. We were the lawyers. We were the scribes that laid down this history. So it's theirs. It's not mine, but... thank you so much for the kind words. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from?
This is Eddie from the Bronx.
Oh, go ahead, brother. Always something interesting from you.
Well, you know, I'm looking at the situation happening there with that brother and sister who shot up that Jewish slaughterhouse. And
okay.
I think I knew that brother. I talked to him. Seems like an intelligent guy, but that whole thing about setting up the Black Hebrew Israelites. I mean, I don't know. It looks like a false flag operation to me.
Could be.
And then we jumped in. Then we jumped in with the situation with Trump killing the general who defeated ISIS. Because, ask yourself, did the United States government have any evidence of saying they defeated ISIS? No, it was him and the Russians who defeated ISIS. America's just there to rob the oil. Like this one, this colonel said on Democracy Now!, the only thing America does is a white colonel saying it. Who worked for this black general, he said, look, the only thing America's at is robbing, stealing, and killing. That's all he said. There's a white colonel saying it.
Well,
right?
You know.
He worked for Colin Powell. He said that's America's foreign policy.
Well,
now,
it's
about
absolutely
we're
true.
We're going to start a war with Iran?
Absolutely true. And certainly, you know, our great ancestor, Dr. John Henry Clark, said Africa is everything that white folks want and white folks don't want to pay for it. Consequently, they steal it and take it. And call
even our
it
reparations,
so,
they don't want to pay for that.
And if you try to take your land back from them or try to take the gold or the diamonds back from them, now you're a terrorist. Ain't that something?
Mm-hmm. Well, they're
trying to
pull that
stuff
with Hong Kong. And, you know, China got nuclear bombs. They're not going to play that game.
Well, you know, you're raising some very important things, and I love the term you use, false flag, because it's possible. And you know, if it is a false flag, you're not surprising us. Because you've done false flags over the last century. That was your justification for bombing Japan, you know, and so many other places. And going there, destroying Grenada, Panama deception, all these other things you did, all false flags. So I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be shocked.
Trump is going to get it that
way.
The presidency.
Right. I won't be shocked.
With this thing of the murder of this general.
Right, but I'm trying to keep mindful of the time, and the all time right. is to
I'm
my
out.
Left. But
I'll catch you.
Okay, now. Take care.
All right.
Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Brownsville.
Oh, good to hear from you, brother.
Okay. Thank you. That brother that called in earlier and said that the Europeans go all around the world digging up artifacts, it's because their history don't go back that far. They steal other people's culture and try to pass it off as theirs.
Yes.
Now, Sister Maddox, right, when she worked at Mega Evers, I used to go there Saturday morning to pick up the audio tapes.
Mm-hmm.
And I
oh,
wound
wow.
up staying there 2 or 3 hours just talking to her.
Wow.
She was a real great woman. I used to love to talk to her.
Yes, she was.
Mm-hmm.
And I love the term that a previous caller used. He said she was quiet fire. I'm going to try to remember that. That's a beautiful description
Correct.
Of Sister Leola.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Quiet fire.
Oh, I just want to say something about these politicians in New York.
Right.
Anything that happened with the school system, New York school system is controlled by the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these black politicians won't say a word. They know the schools are not education, are not educating our children. Every one of these politicians in New York is against charter schools because the teacher union tells them to be against charter schools. Where
right.
charter schools graduate, 98% of them go to college. Where we have our children, the majority of them graduate, they read, what, 4th, 5th grade?
Mm-hmm.
And all of this is controlled by the Jews. All you got to do is just look at the teachers' union.
Mm.
Okay, you're thanks.
Right. You're done?
Yes, thanks.
Okay, well, look, stay strong, brother. Always penetrating insights on your part, so always good to hear from you.
Thank you.
Now, my question again is, as I said last week, who will cry for us? Here you have teachers. One in Palm Coast, Florida, physically abusive, has a history of it, hasn't been fired. Just on leave. That's what they call it, on leave. You have this other teacher right here in New York State teaching little children that they're monkeys. You know, doing a slide presentation, showing them, the 4 children, right next to monkeys, as if none of those white children or the other children that might be there, they have no connection with monkeys, but black children do. Well, you can get the recessive from the dominant, but scientifically you cannot get the dominant from the recessive. That's why 90% of the planet has color, and just 10% of the planet doesn't, because they can only make that which they are. The dominant gene is in us. So, quite simply, they are teaching what they're falsely teaching. They should be fired for that. They don't have the right to humiliate and psychologically destroy those 4 children. And what they're teaching is revisionist history anyway. You know, I mean, that's why you use those Tarzan movies. Tarzan is the king of the jungle. That's why when you have all these movies about ancient Kemet, you just use these false things, and you see all these white pharaohs sitting on the throne. You see white people administrating law and governance in Egypt, and all these Arabian Nights movies. And when you have documentaries on the pyramids, you're talking to Arabs or people from England. Not a black person in sight. Well, take Ashwan Kwesi. Oh, the board. I'm sorry. We got callers. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from? Thank you.
Peace and blessings. Calling from Brooklyn.
Okay. That voice sounds very familiar.
Miss Nikki on the spot.
All right.
I was calling not only peace and blessings to everyone. They are having the Black Lady Theater. I was going to mention that tomorrow they're having a meeting between 6 and 7:30. I intend to come to Professor Mackey's study group. And this is because the gentleman that paid for the
quickly before
mortgage.
We're running out of time. Just say what the meeting is about.
A town hall meeting to save the Black Lady Theater. We should make it a historical
landmark.
What's
the address? Address?
We were not.
We got
474
the time.
Marcus Garvey Boulevard.
Say it again.
474 Marcus Garvey Boulevard.
At what time?
7 p.m.
474 Marcus Garvey Boulevard, 6 to 7:30. All right. Got it. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Quickly, you got 30 seconds. Next caller.
Yeah, Brother Mike, how you doing? This is J&R. I just want to thank you for the information that you put out on the situation at Temple, Texas.
Oh, thank you, brother. Anything else? Oh, he hung up. Well, let me just say quickly for the record, want to thank so much. As you just saw, want to thank Sister Veronica Kitt just alerting me, reminding me to, that we know we still had callers on the line. Certainly want to thank her in the control room. Thank Nat Wood, Sheila Berry. They do an excellent job and make life easier for me out here. So thank them so much for their diligence. Want to say we truly miss Father Lawrence Lucas, Noel Leader, Julian Harper, because when the team is together, we get more information, we get better insights, and it's a good feeling having them around. I miss them, they're family. So want to just say again, Sister Keisha called in and said, we don't have Black elected officials, and it might sound harsh, but you can't refute it. Are they Black first or are they Democrats first? Because almost all of them are part of the Democratic Party. Are they Black or are they Democrats? They're Democratic representatives. They're not Black leaders. They're not Black representatives because they don't represent the Black community. Because if they did, they would be outraged what's going on in Long Island. And if we look close enough, it might be in Queens. It might be in the other boroughs. That type of teaching, making mockery of Black children, making them feel bad about who they are, what they are, and what their life is going to be, what they're going to look forward to. You know, if you reduce people's thinking to think they're monkeys, I mean, Malcolm said he wanted to be a lawyer, and that was taken from him. He could not be a lawyer because of these negative references about, white people would not support you and Black folks wouldn't trust you. And so consequently, you have to do something with your hands, learn to do something with your hands. So consequently, what we'll do is just end up in a situation where we're just a bump on a log. No, we got to have better elected officials, do better, you know, be better, represent our community. And so representing it, then you can go home at night knowing a job well done. In any event, I say to you all, peace and power. Thank you and God bless.